While I was restoring this SiliconGraphics O2 workstation, I ended up getting this 1600 SW flat panel display,
which in turn needed me to upgrade SGI IRIX to a more recent release. But the upgrade to IRIX 6.5.30 was not as straightforward as you may think.
Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. For those not so familiar with SiliconGraphics, here's some primer. The company was founded in 1982 by James Clark, an electrical engineering professor from Stanford, taking with him a group of 7 graduate students and research people. They had been doing development on the so-called geometry engine while at the university, and then later they were taking said geometry engine to lay the foundation for SiliconGraphics. The name was no coincidence either, as they had put the logic into an integrated circuit to bring the extra hardware-assisted punch for computer graphics processing. Nowadays, we have hardware rendering in all modern GPUs, but for 1981, this was still groundbreaking. So, the folks at SGI put all that together into the geometry systems board and placed it into their first graphics workstation, the IRIX 2000, which is a short for the Integrated Raster Imaging System. And while at the beginning, SGI's used the GL2 operating system, a descendant from AT&T Unix System 5, SiliconGraphics eventually began the development of their own Unix variant to go along with the introduction of MIPS-based workstations. This would see the light in the mid-80s, although the operating system would be called simply 4D1 for the early releases. And this is where my episode sponsor for today, PCBWay, comes into play. PCBWay offers a wide range of services around CNC machining, PCB production, including full assembly services and 3D printing on over a dozen of prototyping materials. For any electronic project you publish to the PCBWay community, you'll receive a 10% kickback on production cost if it's picked up for production by someone else. Use the link in the video description below to join up with PCBWay. The name IRIX was only appearing as late as with 41 release 3.0 in 1988, and it would still take another 5 years until 1993 with IRIX 5 until the 41 designation was eventually dropped. Now, I tried finding out when actually 41 was introduced, but I couldn't find the real date. Sources point out that 41 was specific to the MIPS line of workstations, of which the IRIX 4D/60 from 1987 was SGI's first MIPS workstation. Although this website claims that IRIX was introduced as early as 1982, I have my doubts. Even when taking into account that development on 41/IRIX started ahead of time, as it had to be ready when the workstation was announced in 1987, I would put the 41/IRIX release 1.0 timeline to begin around 1984 or 1985-ish. Though that's my guessworking, as I have no source to bring that down to earth, so don't take my opinion as a real fact. Still, what's sure about SGI IRIX is that it as well is an AT&T Unix descendant. IRIX 3 was based on Unix System 5 Release 3 and incorporated some 4.3 BSD additions, and IRIX 5 eventually was based off Unix System 5 Release 4. However, the farther back I went, the obscure and incomplete the information becomes, as I found nothing about the 41 originally was based off. IRIX is also not mentioned on Wikipedia's Unix timeline map, so I just put the known releases in for your reference. And given my assumption that 41 actually began its life in around 1984 or 85, it's reasonable to assume that the early releases of 41 and IRIX were actually based on Unix System 5 Release 2. Again, no hard facts, just my assumptions.
Yeah, I see. It's super interesting historical information, or absence thereof. But you wanted to show us how to upgrade SGI IRIX.
Right. To install that digital flat panel interface into my O2 workstation, I had to be running at least IRIX 6.5.2. But I didn't have this one, so I decided to actually go for the latest available release, which is 6.5.30. Now, when pulling in for an upgrade, you must always have two CD sets. One is the so-called foundation CDs, at a minimum the install disk, the foundation 1 and 2, applications, and depending on your use case, add-ons like the NFS disks. Then you need to have the overlay disks, which in case of IRIX 6.5.30 is the install and overlays 1, overlays 2 and 3, plus the applications and the supplemental applications disk. Now, the first mistake many people are making is that they just pull in the overlay disks and end up on a gazillion of unresolved conflicts in Software Manager. This is because you're required to load the foundation disks first and only then load the overlay disks. There's two reasons for that. Number one, the original foundation disks are an entitlement to use IRIX. At least in the old days, hardware owners could only use IRIX, and the CDs can be seen like a dongle, allowing you to install the OS upgrades. Number 2. The overlays were simply not installable without the base files from the foundation CDs, as sometimes they would reinstall parts of the system using the base files from the foundation CD, with changed or updated files being infused by the overlay CDs. That's why, to apply the upgrade, you have to load both disk sets, the base first and the overlay second.
But wait a minute, you still have 65 installation conflicts there.
Correct. Software Manager complains about not finding IRIX's EOE.SW.base distribution, although the IRIX execution environment is actually installed. The issue is that SGI at some point changed some internal references, which makes the dependency detection break for the overlays. In order to fix that, you'll have to load the install and overlay 1 disk all alone and navigate to the install tools directory. In there, you'll find the patch 5086, which contains an updated version of the installation tools. Just install this one first, quit Software Manager and start over. You'll also notice that by doing so, Software Manager no longer runs release 3.3, but now release 4.1. From here on, I'm now opening up all base CDs and then the overlays in sequence. This way, I'll end up only with 7 install conflicts, of which some are related to Java, the Mozilla Java plugin, and the ESP Print Pro package. I'll just go with unselecting these to continue, and eventually all conflicts are gone. The installation will take a good while, during which I'm occasionally asked to flip in also some of the base CDs. I also fired up the graphical OS view, which shows the current resource usage. The installation is causing quite some user space load. Eventually the installation is done and asking me to quit, which I'm doing. This in turn causes ArcUSL to run. This by itself took yet another 10 minutes to complete. Upon rebooting the system, I'll then check the version on the system console, which would advertise itself as 6.5.30F. Update complete.
May I comment on that? I think you forgot to mention the difference about maintenance and feature stream.
Nah, I just skipped it. Because that difference only existed in IRIX earlier than release 6.5.23. SGI expired the differentiation between the two, whereas the former gave you just the base OS upgrades and the latter introduced new features. Starting effectively from 6.5.23, hardware owners had no more automatically the right to get OS upgrades, but had to buy an active support contract. But actually the system did ask me at the very beginning about it, and I actually chose the feature stream.
As you saw, upgrading IRIX in a more or less conflict-free and seamless manner is possible if you pay attention to the proper sequence. I'm happy as this is all what was needed to get my O2 ready for use with the flat panel display adapter. But would you have gone with the 6.5.30 as well, or would you have picked an earlier release? And why? I'm looking forward to a nice discussion. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Next video is coming Sunday in a week. And if you can't wait, why don't you check out any of my other videos in the meantime? Thanks for watching, and see you next time.